never change. You never fail, oh God. True are your promises. True are your promises. You never change. You never fail, oh God.
So we raise up.
Wide is your love and grace. Wide is your love and grace. You never change. You never fail, oh God.
So we raise up.
Yeah, we raise up holy hands. Praise the Holy One. Wide and in.
Reading from Isaiah 43, 1 through 7. But now thus says the Lord, He who created you, O Jacob, He who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by my name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Seba in exchange for you. Because you are precious in my eyes and honored, and I love you, I give men in return for you, people in exchange for your life. Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your offsprings from the east, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give up, to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar, and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created by my glory, whom I informed by my handmaid. This is the word of the Lord.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound taught my heart to fear and grace my fears freely. How precious did that grace look the hour I first believed. My chains are set free, my God, my Savior has ransomed me. Like a flood, His mercy rings, unending love, amazing. The Lord has promised. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secure. He will my shield and portion as long as life endures. My chains are gone. My chains are my God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rained, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon
minute.
Hey, Pastor, can you
let me try that again? All right. We are having a little bit of a technical issue here. We're going to try and get that resolved real quick so that we can get everything running the way we want it to. We have some new software, so we're working on trying to make sure that's working the way we want it to work right now. All right. Hopefully, if you guys can see that, it says, we're glad you're here. Raise your hands just so I can see that. Good. All right. Hopefully, we are back up and running. Never quite know what's going to happen week to week as they continue to update the software for security reasons. We are glad that all of you are here with us. We're going to have Rachel lead us in a covenant reading here. But before she does, we're going to have a few announcements that we want to walk through real quick. First off, tonight at 6 p.m., we are going to be having our Gospel in Life training. So we want to make sure that all of you know, plan to be there. If you're part of our Gospel in Life Strengthening the Stakes strategy and training, we want to invite you all. We'll send out that link right about 5:45 or so to make sure all of you can participate in that. Next thing we want to mention to you is that this coming Thursday, May 7th, is the National Day of Prayer. Now, the National Day of Prayer has been designated that way for some time over the last few years, but this year it has special meaning for us in that we are trying to strongly encourage people at home, all of you, to spend the day in prayer and fasting. Many of you are already joining us in the prayer 7:14 emphasis. You're praying at 7:14 in the morning, 7:14 at night as we pray 2 Chronicles 7:14. If you want more information about that, you can check on our church Facebook page. We have links there. And then on Friday or Thursday, we'll be sending out resources to help you pray all day long during our National Day of Prayer. We also want to announce to you some amazing news. We think it's pretty cool news, and that is that we believe that on May 24th, Sunday, May 24th, that's three Sundays from today, that we are planning at this point to have Redeemer come together as a church, as drive-in church. We're going to try a drive-in church service where you will come in your car, stay socially distanced from each other. And we're going to announce some more details, but it appears that we have a couple of local businesses that are willing to let us do this. The county health office has given their clearance for it. So at this point, we are working towards that end, and we want you to be praying for that to happen. One of the things that we want to encourage you to remember is this, that as good as it is for us to gather virtually, Jesus didn't step into our lives through a TV screen, though he could have. He came into our physical presence, and he came into the realm of people in three dimensions. And we don't want to forget that we are called to live out the reality of being the church in that same way. So plan now to be there on Sunday, May 24th, as we get ready to do church in a new way. We're going to be trying it out a couple of times. It looks like at the end of May and maybe in early June as we try to figure out how to reopen as a church body. So be praying to that end that God gives your leaders wisdom and all the insights and resources that we need to have. But now Rachel's going to lead us through our church covenant.
Good morning, everybody. Thumbs up if you can hear me. Perfect. Thanks. Okay. Every month we have a chance to read a portion of the covenant that everyone signs upon entering membership here at RBC. I will read the part that says leader, and even though your mic may be muted, I want to encourage you to read along as you read the part that says congregation. You can follow along on the screens, right? Perfect. Having, as we trust, been brought by divine grace to repent and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and having been baptized upon our profession of faith in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, we do now, relying on his gracious aid, solemnly and joyfully enter into this covenant with one another as one body in Christ under his headship. Our united purpose is to glorify God by being a gospel-centered community. Our biblical priorities are to worship God, proclaim the gospel, disciple believers, serve everyone, and steward all of life to the glory of God. As servants of Jesus Christ and following in his example, we commit ourselves to lovingly serve all people, including our enemies as they are. We will give special attention and effort to the service of the lost, hurting, needy, and brokenhearted. Further, we will seek the good of the community in which we live, knowing that God has commanded us to seek its welfare.
Well, good morning, Redeemer. I want to first say thank you to Zach and Melissa for leading us in those songs prior. Thank you so much for using your gifts to serve the body. This is the song that was played at the beginning of service.
My flesh may fail, my God, you never will.
Before our message, we come before the Lord to confess our sins, to ask his forgiveness, and receive his cleansing, and to ask the Holy Spirit to illuminate our pastor's heart and our hearts as we look forward to our morning message. Please join me in prayer. Please help us, good and gracious Father, for we are a needy, needy people, a desperately needy people, and if we fail to grow closer to you through immersion in your word, singing hymns and spiritual songs and praying, then we so easily grow away from you, following the seductive siren calls of the world, the flesh, and the devil. Search us, O God, and know our hearts. Try us and know our thoughts, and see if there be any wicked ways in us, and lead us in your way everlasting. Loosen our too tight grip on our Amazon rhinestones that we futilely hope will satisfy us. Screen porn, junk food, credit card overspending, gossip, hurtful speech, taking the praise and glory that should go to you. Instead, Father, may we confess and repent of our individual and collective sins that you reveal to us. May we claim the forgiveness and cleansing that you offer through your resurrected Son Jesus' blood that was shed for us and makes even our most scarlet sins as white as snow. May we relinquish those Amazon rhinestones for your invaluable, enduring treasure, inexhaustible, shareable gifts to us to use if we will but claim them. The fruit of the Spirit, listening ears and hearts, the language of compassion, resources to generously employ in the name of Jesus, and especially encouragement and hope of the gospel good news. As Pastor Chris launches us into an exploration of 1 Corinthians, may we fasten our safety belts and prepare to land in a culture of dysfunctional folks in many ways similar to us today. Give our tour guide, Pastor Chris, your wisdom, your words, your energy, your focus, to remind us anew that the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. May we emerge eager to receive and know the things that are freely given to us by you, so that we will be more intentional and effective laborers together with you, loving you supremely and loving others selflessly, as a contemporary theologian has reminded us, as you conform us more and more into Christ-likeness through the working of your Holy Spirit. We anticipate eagerly our 1 Corinthians adventure. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, thank you, Gaynell. I want to invite all of you, if you brought a copy of God's Word with you today, to open your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians. Now, I believe that for most of you that are a regular part of Redeemer, we were able to get out to you this week one of these ESV scripture journals. And we want to invite you to keep that with you throughout this series. You'll find inside not only the text of 1 Corinthians, but you'll also find that there's places for you to write and make notes throughout this series that you can follow along with. Of course, we do want you to have paper notes that you can have. And so we have put a link on our YouVersion events site that will allow you to download the notes for each of the messages in this series. And we also have provided those notes electronically through those the YouVersion app. Now, if you don't have any of those resources, but you would like to, just send us an email. We'll get you a scripture journal, even if we have to mail it to you in some way. But we want you to have those resources and tools while we go through this series that we have entitled Ordinary Saints. Now, we're going to invite you to dive into, as I think Gaynell just said, a bit of a dysfunctional church. And this church that Paul wrote this book of Corinthians to had quite the story. If you don't know where Corinth is, you take a look at the map that's on your screen right now, and you can see a red dot there. It's right on the isthmus between the Achaean, or now we call it the Peloponnesian Peninsula, and the mainland of Greece. And this city has been populated and torn down several times in their history. They were a great ancient Greek city long before the Apostle Paul showed up, about 150 years or so before this letter was written. The Corinthian city that existed there entered into a war, and they were torn down, literally down to the ground. And they spent about a century without anybody being there. But the location was too good for the Roman Empire to not rebuild. So they built a colony there. And the reason why is that tiny little neck there between the Peloponnesian Peninsula and the rest of Greece meant that you could actually move goods and shipping items, and even ships themselves could be pulled along a road across that narrow little isthmus there, and then you could avoid taking that big trip all the way around that peninsula as you were trying to make your way from what was then called Asia or Turkey towards Italy. And it's to this place that the Apostle Paul came on his second missionary journey, sometime around AD 50, about 50 years after the advent of Christ, about 20 years after his death. Paul goes on a mission trip into northeast Greece, as we would call it today, or into Macedonia. And he got himself in trouble in a place called Thessalonica and had to run away from there, and had to run to a city called Berea and got himself in trouble there. And then he ran down to Athens and was there for a little bit doing some ministry. But eventually he made his way to the port city of Corinth. And it was a phenomenal city, a city where trade was constantly present. It was an economic center of the ancient world. It was also the headquarters for the Isthmian Games. It's like the Olympic Games of those times. And it was also a place of great religious worship. They had all kinds of temples and idols there. In the ancient Corinth, that we know there was a temple there that had 1,000 cult prostitutes associated with it. So you could go and have sex while you're doing worship, which was an interesting conception. Where it's not likely that by the time that Paul was here, they had that same grouping of idols there, but they did have these great big ancient temples that archaeologists have found, which Paul refers to, and there was certainly a great deal of immorality. Some scholars have said that the ancient city of Corinth was like Las Vegas, New York, and Los Angeles all rolled up into one. So you want to have kind of that context for the city. So Paul spent about 18 months there establishing the church. He met some of his good friends, Priscilla and Aquila, there for a while. He worked in local industry as a tent maker there, and then committed himself to full-time ministry when some of his buddies showed up and they could help him support him there. He spent those 18 months there and then moved on from there, briefly stopping in the place that he would build as his next center of ministry, Ephesus, and then he went back home before his third missionary journey. It was from Corinth that he wrote both the book of 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, writing back to that church that he had had to flee so quickly after establishing them. He came back on his third missionary journey, though, and established himself in the center of your map there. You'll see a place called Ephesus, and that's where he put himself. And it's from Ephesus that he wrote the letter to the Corinthian church. We know this is at least Paul's second letter. We call it 1 Corinthians, but he mentions in 1 Corinthians a prior letter. So we know there was at least one other letter that we don't have a copy of. And it's to this church that he is writing. And so with kind of that as an introduction and a background, we want to dive into now reading the first 9 verses of this letter that Paul wrote to this church. Paul, called by the will of God to be an apostle of Christ Jesus and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God that is in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints together with all those who in every place call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that was given you in Christ Jesus, that in every way you were enriched in him in all speech and all knowledge, even as the testimony about Christ was confirmed among you, so that you are not lacking in any gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will sustain you to the end, guiltless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And this is God's holy and inerrant word. May he add his blessing as we go on the journey that Gaynell was describing to study together with the Corinthian church. I gave you a brief introduction into the Corinthian church, and I want to give you a quick insight into why we called this series, Ordinary Saints. And we're going to do that by going through the passage that I just read. We're going to see that there are 3 key issues that Paul is addressing in just those 9 verses. When you and I tend to read these opening sections of these books, I know if you're like me, many of us are tempted to kind of just skim through these early verses and think, well, this is just Paul's way of greeting. But that's not the way Paul thought, and it's not the way ancient writers wrote. What he's doing in these 9 verses is critical. He's setting up his theme for the entire study. And he wants the Corinthian church to address these 3 major questions. And so right there, even in 9 verses, he packs in an immense amount of truth. He wants to ask them these questions. Do you know who you are? Do you know who you are? The second question he wants to ask them is, do you treasure God's people? And the third question he wants to ask them is, do you trust God? Do you trust God to be at work in your life, in your church, to do things that are for your good and for his glory? So 3 questions. Do you know who you are? Do you treasure God's people? And do you trust God to be at work in your life and in your church? So with that kind of outline, let's dig into these first 9 verses. Do you know who you are? Even today, one of the key questions that everybody always wants to ask about life itself is, who am I? So we take personality inventories, we look at astrology, and we say, oh, this is my astrological sign, as if that somehow identifies us. We look at all kinds of psychology and therapy to kind of answer this question. But Paul wants the Corinthian people, he wants us to know that we are who God says we are. We are who God says we are, and he wants to remind them of that. He wants them to remember what God has done for them and who he is making them into being. So in those verses that we just read, you're going to see 7 key truths about who Paul says the Corinthian church is. And so it's worth us asking, do we know who we are? And Paul wants the Corinthians and us to know that we are people who have been sainted. Now, you may not feel like a saint. I know that I often don't feel like a saint, but Paul says, you are, in fact, a saint. In fact, he says to the Corinthian church, you are those that have been sanctified. You've been made holy. That's what that word means. You've been made into a sanctuary, a place of worship. And he's going to come back to that theme throughout the book of 1 Corinthians over and over again. He's going to say, remember, your life is a sanctuary. It's been set aside for worship unto God. So you've been sanctified in Christ Jesus. When you came to a relationship with Jesus, you were made into something different, a place of holiness. And then he says, you've been called to be saints. And the word there probably is best translated holy persons or holy people. Sanctuary is pluralized. So you have been sanctified and you are called to be a holy people. And we'll see why that was so important here in just a minute. But what is he saying? He's saying that we've been given a purity through a relationship with Jesus. We've been made clean. Or declared clean. He even brings it back up in this same nine verses. He says, you've been made guiltless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Is that how you feel? Do you feel guiltless? I mean, I don't know about you, but day in and day out, as I am unkind or harsh or maybe not who I think God wants me to be, I can develop guilt. But Paul's not talking about felt guilt. He's saying that when we come before the living God, we've been declared guiltless. Why is that? Well, because of what Jesus has done for us. And that means that we've not only just been declared holy or something like that, but we've been given a spiritual condition. You might even say a spiritual place in the presence of God. If you look at a letter he wrote to the Colossian church, he says this, you who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death. Jesus has taken those of us that were cut off from God because of our sins, those of us who were innately rebellious, those of us who were living out of that rebellion and doing evil things, in his death, he's brought us into a relationship with God in order to present us holy and blameless and above reproach. In other words, Jesus didn't just wipe out your sins. He brought you into a holy place to be a holy people before a holy God. He declared you clean, covered you with his righteousness, but he wants you to understand you have been made something different. You could think of it this way. We've been given an empowered purpose, a calling for our lives. And that calling is to be holy. This is the will of God, Paul would write from Corinth to the Thessalonian church. He'd say to them, you want to know God's will for your life? So many of us get caught up in that. God, what's the job you have for me? What's the mate you have for me? How do I live out the reality of retirement? And we're asking those kinds of questions on the day-to-day basis. And Paul would give you an answer like this. You want to know God's will? God's will is for you to become more and more holy. God's will for your life is your sanctification, for you to look more and more like the place of worship that he has made you into through the blood of his son. And it's not something that just happens overnight. So often we as Christians, we want to go away on like a spiritual retreat or have some spiritual mountaintop experience, and we want to come back and never, ever be back to who we once were. But that's not the way this works. While we've been declared innocent by the blood of Jesus, washed clean, given a holy place before a holy God, we've now entered into a process of becoming more and more like Jesus, more and more holy. And that requires a commitment from us. That's why Paul would write again from Corinth to the Thessalonians. He would say, I know you've been sanctified, but I'm praying that the God of peace himself, the God of spiritual wholeness, that's what the word peace means, will himself make you all that he has declared you to be, sanctify you completely. So one way to think about it is this: Jesus has made us holy by his grace, bought us with his blood, declared us that way by God's grace, and yet more and more we have to experience that in reality. We have been freed from the penalty of sin because Jesus has paid it. We've been set free from sin's power. We're going to talk more about that here in just a bit, but we are in the process of getting sin out of our lives and unbelief out of our lives and becoming a place that is truly holy. Now, here's why this is so important and why this sets up the whole book. Because the Corinthian church was made up of very ordinary saints. They had many struggles, weaknesses, and habitual sins. So that you and I can feel like this book relates to us, I just want to outline very quickly for you a few of their sin problems. Okay, so here's what you're going to see as we go through the book of Corinthians. You're going to see that, first off, they had major divisions in their church. This is a church that liked to fight. And they fought over all kinds of things. They fought over who they were following as leaders. Did they like some of them? Paul's successor is pastor there, a man named Apollos, or did they like Paul better? They fought over whether or not some of them had more important charismatic gifts or signs of prophecy and tongues and whether or not they were valid. They fought over doctrine. There was all kinds of doctrinal confusion in the church, especially because they made the cross of Jesus less important as they emphasized their personal experiences. They kept wanting to talk about what they had experienced instead of making the good news of Jesus their good news. There was people that were boasting and striving after position. And this doesn't sound like a very nice church to be a part of, does it? But if you keep on going through the book, you'll see that they had worse problems than that, believe it or not. They had sexual immorality and even incest going on in the church. And they weren't doing anything about it. They failed to enact church discipline. And so they have this sin happening amongst them and they wouldn't do anything about it. And why would that be? Well, probably because they were busy suing each other. They would get into little arguments, and instead of handling it within the church and solving the problem there, they would take each other to court, and probably over very, very small things based on what we can see. In the midst of all of this, there was some group in the church that said, you know, it doesn't really matter if you get married. You can have sex with anybody that you want, and singleness isn't important. You know, if you're single, then you're probably not as good of a Christian as the rest of us. So there's all kinds of devaluing of marriage and singleness in the same church. There were people who were recklessly offending the consciences of weaker believers. They were people that said, I don't care if somebody struggles with my beliefs. I get my way and I don't care about you. In the midst of the church, there was another group of people that were apparently decided, hey, being a Christian means I can keep going back and forth to the temples and sacrificing to idols. And if that doesn't shock you, there were people getting drunk at the Lord's Supper while they were fighting over who got the best seats. Okay, now I hope you're beginning to get a sense that this church was messed up. They had serious spiritual problems. They had pride and arguments about spiritual gifts. They didn't love each other the way they were supposed to. They got into arguments about worship. Who was going to get to speak on a particular Sunday? What were the roles of men and women in the church? They're having all of these discussions, and it just keeps on going. They had a major theological issue because they didn't believe in the resurrection of the dead. And Paul's going to spend a good bit of time explaining why you have to believe in the resurrection of the dead if you believe in Jesus. And that, by the way, didn't result in them being very nice people. They were stingy. In fact, repeatedly, Paul has to address the fact that the Corinthians loved money a lot, and they weren't exactly in the habit of giving money to poorer people. They thought, those folks need to go earn it. Paul's going to end up having to rebuke that. They had wrongly separated the idea of spiritual wisdom and giftedness and experiences and having spiritual power from holy living. Okay. Is that exhausting just to go through? It is to me, just to imagine this. This letter is written to people that Paul calls saints. Do you know who you are? See, just like the imperfect and redeemed Corinthians, you have been sainted. Paul wants to remind them this is who you are, and then he's going to call them to live out the reality of that identity. He's going to say to them over and over again, the good news of Jesus came to you with power, and it has declared you God's saints and is making you more and more into that saintly reality. Well, he doesn't just say that they're saints, though. He says that there's more to who they are. He says, you're not just saints. You've been called. You've been called by God. You've heard God's voice speak into your life. He says, you've been called to be saints together. He's certainly saying you've been called to be holy ones like me. One of the groups in the church was arguing that only certain people were holy people, people like Paul or Apollos or certain leaders, or maybe if you had certain spiritual experiences. But Paul says, no, you've all been called to be holy ones. I was called to be an apostle. And our brother Sosthenes, who's one of the leaders in the church, but who's visiting me here in Ephesus, guess what? He's been called by God too. We've all been called to be saints together. And that calling is a calling into a fellowship, into a relationship with God. Sometimes we speak of the call of God as if some people have the call of God and other people don't have the call of God. And Paul is eager to remind them that every Christian has been called by God into a holy relationship, a holy fellowship with God. He writes there in verse 9, God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. You have been called by God. That's one way you know that you're a saint, is God has placed his calling upon your life and said, I want you to live out the reality of a relationship with me. And that means that something happens. You're no longer, if you've been called by God, calling on the world to provide its answers. You're no longer looking to news or to wealth or position or to influence or to beauty to make your significance, your security, your satisfaction. Instead, you call on God for all of those things. And so he says, we've been called together with all those who call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. The called people start calling out to Jesus. If you want to know the difference between a Christian and a non-Christian, you can emphasize the fact that they've been called by God into that relationship, but you also have to say that they are the people who now call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. They used to call upon other authorities. They used to call upon other saviors, but now they call upon the name of Jesus. A person who is a Christian is a person who calls on Jesus for my significance, Jesus for my security, Jesus for my satisfaction. One of the favorite verses of the New Testament church was Joel 2:32. It shall come to pass that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. We know it's one of the favorites because it's not only referred to here in the verse that we just looked at, but it's in early sermons. It's in most of the major writers of the New Testament. They quote this passage. They said, when God called me, I began to call on him. And that's an amazing thing because everyone who calls on the name of the Lord, those of us that have stopped trusting in ourselves, stopped looking to the idols of this world to be our satisfaction, we call upon God and know that he will save us. So do you know who you are? You've been sainted. You've been called. You've also been submitted. You've been submitted. When Paul talks about those who have been called, he says this, together with all those who call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. And the word Lord is not just some abstract title. It's an issue of authority. When Paul says, they call upon the name of the Lord. He's saying they've brought themselves under the authority of Jesus. And he doubles down here in this verse to say, he's my Lord and he's your Lord and he's the Lord of everyone who truly follows him. That means they've been submitted to Jesus' authority. It is impossible to be a Christian and not be under the authority of Jesus Christ. Do you know that? There are many people who were sold a form of Christianity that is not authentic, that says that if you just trust in Jesus or invite him into your heart, then you will be saved. And it's a partial truth because there is a need for us to ask for God's grace and mercy. But some people say, I ask for God's grace and mercy, but I don't want Jesus to be in charge of my life. Look what Paul wrote to the Roman church. He says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, Jesus is in charge of my life, he's in charge of my day to day, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Notice that you must place your faith in Jesus, but you must also come under his authority. And we think of that in terms of repentance. You're turning away from the other authorities, from self-will, from selfishness, from everything that you wanted before. And you said, no, those desires are no longer in charge of my life. Jesus is Lord of my life. My parents aren't the Lord of my life. Ultimately, my government is not my ultimate authority in my life. My family isn't the ultimate authority. My career is not the ultimate authority. My boss is not the ultimate authority. No, the ultimate authority of my life is Jesus. He is Lord, and I have been submitted to him. Do you know who you are? You've not just had this experience by yourself. Paul's eager to take this divisive church that he loves so very much, and he wants to remind them in these verses, you've been assembled. You weren't just doing this on your own. It's not like one of you is more of a Christian than another. In fact, you've been brought into a group, an assembly of saints. It's not just that one of you is a saint and others of you are sort of half Christians. No, you've all these saints have been assembled together, and you've been assembled in particular or local ways and universal ways. So if you look back in the passage again, look at how much he packs into this one verse, verse 2. To the church of God that is in Corinth. Now that word church that he uses there is the word assembly. To the assembly of God, the assembly of God's saints that is in Corinth, called to be saints together with everybody in every place who call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Here's something you need to understand. When you came to Jesus Christ, you were put into a particular local church in a place like the Church of God that is in Corinth. You were in an assembly in a local place, but you were also called to be saints together with everybody in every place who calls upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We have the local church and the universal church, which means this, that right now, you have brothers and sisters you have never met in the Ecuadorian jungle. You have brothers and sisters in Christ in the vast favelas that are outside of Rio de Janeiro. You have brothers and sisters in Christ that you have not yet met who are in Wuhan, China, and they are more your family than many of your biological relatives who don't follow Jesus. You have brothers and sisters in Christ in Singapore and in Moscow. You have brothers and sisters in Christ that are in Bangladesh and people who are in Nairobi and Mumbai and across this world. You have people that are calling upon the same Lord that you call upon, and you're part of that great assembly of the saints down through the ages, and you are also part of a local church called Redeemer Baptist Church in many of your cases. So you've been assembled by God together. I want to remind you of something that we studied a few weeks ago, those of us that are in the Gospel and Life training. Tim Keller says, we cannot know God, change deeply, or win the world apart from community. Paul's going to argue over and over again with the Corinthian church that they were making a key mistake in their holiness when they looked to experience or spiritual knowledge, and they didn't look to their community to understand that God had not accidentally put them in this group, but rather that those people were there to help them know him, become something different, and bear witness to the world. Is that the way you view the church? Is that the way you view your church? Think about it. Do you know who you are? Paul says you've been graced and enriched. Graced and enriched. I love the way that he puts this in this passage. He says, I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that was given you in Christ Jesus, that in every way you were enriched in him in all speech and all knowledge. You've been given logos, that's speech, and knowledge. You've been given this through God's grace. This isn't something you've earned or could buy from God. God gave it to you freely, and he gave it to you in such abundance that you could call it, you could act like you've got wealth in this. So you've been given gospel fluency, the ability to talk about spiritual things that you never could talk about before because of God's grace to you. You've been given spiritual knowledge. You know the truth of the gospel, and that truth is not simply something that's cognitive in your mind. It's a truth that you have experienced as well. It's not just a truth that has come to you through some emotional experience. It has real, concrete boundaries and lines and hard edges to it, but it's good to have it. And God's given you that. He's given you spiritual gifts, just like he's given to the Corinthian church. And he had graced and enriched this church so that they were not lacking in any gift, he says to the Corinthians. He's like, none of you, some of you are like saying, this person's got this spiritual gift and I don't have it. And that means I'm not as good of a Christian because I don't have the same spiritual gift as this person. And those people were saying, yeah, that's right. You're not as good as me because you don't have my spiritual gifts. And those charismati, those signs of grace, Paul's going to tell the church, guess what? Everybody's got the gifts, but they're for the body. And your body is not lacking in any spiritual gift because God's given those gifts for the good of the church. And you need each other so that you can have all of the gifts that God intends for you. He's given you enough. You know, that's so hard to believe sometimes in church life, that God has given us enough spiritual gifts. You know, as a pastor, I'm always praying that God's going to call forth different leaders and people to use their gifts. But God wants to remind me and you that we've been graced and enriched sufficiently. Look at this passage from 2 Peter, where Peter says, his divine power, God's divine power, has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence. What you and I need to take away from that is this reality. God is not holding out on us. He's given us everything we need to live out the spiritual lives that he has called us to in a real world. He wants us to be his people living out that godly sainthood, and he's graced us with all that is necessary. Do you know who you are? You've been confirmed. Some of you may have come up in a Catholic or Lutheran church, and you may know a little bit more about confirmation. Confirmation in those churches is a time where the church affirms that you are a genuine believer, usually by taking you through a set of courses and trying to test your knowledge and see if you've got a faith that you're willing to affirm out loud. But that's not quite what Paul means here when he says we've been confirmed. What he's saying is that the testimony about Jesus is confirmed or given evidence among you. He says, Corinthians, I know you're Christians. With all your messed up problems and all your weaknesses and all your brokennesses, I know that you are Christians because the testimony of Jesus was made evident among you. from Corinth, Paul would write to the Thessalonian church a similar phrase. He would say, "For we know, brothers, loved by God, that God has chosen you." How does Paul know this? He says, "I know this because our gospel, the good news of Jesus, came to you, not just in word, but it came to you in power and in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction. I've seen the gospel," Paul said. "I saw it at work in you. You got convicted by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit moved upon you and brought you into saving faith, and he gave you spiritual power. And that was not just some external truths that you mouthed, some words that you said. No, no. The good news came to you in life transformation." And so he says, "Corinthians, I know that you've been confirmed to belong to Jesus because I've seen the evidence and testimony of Jesus amongst you." Is that how you look around and see other people in the church? "I've seen God at work in this person's life. I know who they once were once upon a time." And so, God, we cry out and say, "I'm so thankful for these people." We'll talk more about that here in just a second. The last principle that Paul wants to point out in this section is when he asks them, "Do you know who you are?" He says, "You've been sustained even though or because you are waiting." You've been sustained by God. If you go back into 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 7, you'll see that he says to the Corinthians, "As you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will sustain you to the end." You ever wonder if you're going to wake up tomorrow and forsake the Christian faith? Do you ever wonder if you're going to wake up tomorrow and fail so badly that God's done with you? Well, what if it doesn't really ultimately depend on you? Don't hear me saying that you're not responsible to continue in the faith, as Paul would admonish many of the churches. But he wants to remind them right here that Jesus, who started this work in their lives, is going to complete that work. He's going to sustain them even as they are waiting for him to show back up. Jesus completes what he began. And that's good news for you and me, because so many days I don't feel like a saint, but I know that Jesus is doing a work to make me into what he wants me to be. Paul would write to the Philippian church, "I am sure of this, he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ." We can be confident because our spiritual lives aren't ultimately dependent on us, but ultimately dependent upon the grace of God through Jesus to each of us. Brothers and sisters, do you long for the return of Jesus? One of the ways we sustain our faith is we stop looking around day-to-day events and we're looking for the living Savior, Jesus Christ, who is resurrected from the grave to complete that which he has promised and return for his people. Paul's going to end his letter to this Corinthian church, and he's going to end it with a phrase, strangely writing in the phrase in the language of Aramaic, a language that most of these Greek people would not speak. He inserts an Aramaic word, Maranatha. And they would probably have to go to their Google Translates or their equivalent at that time, and they would have to realize, oh, Maranatha, what does that mean? Our Lord, come. Come, Lord Jesus. This was the heart cry of the early church. Jesus, we want you to come back. We want to experience you now, but we want more. We want you to finish this work that you have begun. And that's certainly the heart that God wants each of us to have. Okay. Now, we spent most of our time today asking this first question: do you know who you are? Do you know that you've been sainted? Do you know that you've been called? Do you know that you've been assembled? Do you know that you've been graced and enriched? Do you know that you've been confirmed? Do you know that you've been sustained? But do you know that that's happening not just with you, but with the people you can see on your screen right now in little boxes, the people that God has assembled you with? Do you know that God is doing this work amongst them? In fact, not just do you know it, but do you treasure them? Do you delight in them? Is it exciting to you to see the work of God in these other people's lives? Do you treasure God's people? Paul's going to keep reminding the Corinthians that they're not just simply to know in an abstract way that these other people are experiencing the grace of God. He wants them to know this in a firsthand way that brings them delight. So here's a couple of checks that he puts on our soul. Are you thankful for God's people? Look at how he wrote to this Corinthian church. Now keep in mind all the problems I outlined earlier. And he says, I give thanks to my God always for you. He's thankful for people who are committing incest and getting drunk at the Lord's Supper and having lawsuits and fighting and division. He says, I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that was given you in Christ Jesus. I thank God because there's a bigger story than your sin. There's a better story than your sin. The story is the grace of God that was given even to you, even to those of you that are suing each other, even to those of you that are committing idolatry, even to those of you that can't get along in the church. God's writing a bigger story than your sin. And he says, I give thanks to my God always for you. And Paul didn't just do this for the Corinthian church. He felt this way about all Christians. As he moved around the Mediterranean world, let's do a quick survey, okay? To the Roman church, Paul would write this. I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you because your faith is proclaimed in all the world. Paul was thankful for the Roman Christians. And then to the Ephesian Christians, he wrote, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. He says, I never stop thanking God for you. And to the Philippian church, he wrote, I thank my God in all my remembrance of you. So as he moves around the Mediterranean world, Paul's full of thanksgiving for the work of God in different people. To the Colossian church, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you. Every single time, just ask yourself, when you were praying this morning, were you thanking God for this church? Were you thanking God for the Christians across town? For the people across this region, your brothers and sisters in our association of churches, believers across the world? To the Thessalonians from Corinth, Paul wrote, we give thanks to God always for all of you, not just some of you, not just my favorites, not just those of you that have got your spiritual act together, those of you that are perfectly living out the gospel. No, no, we give thanks to God always for all of you, constantly mentioning you in my prayers. So with that quick survey, is it enough to just give thanks to God for your fellow believers? Or do you need to be active? We want to thank God for our fellow Christians and the work he's doing in their life. But Paul's not just giving thanks. He's working actively for God's grace and peace to be experienced in the lives of his fellow believers. And in fact, that's his goal in all of his ministry. So we find here in 1 Corinthians 1:3, Paul says, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Scholars point out how Paul takes an ordinary greeting from the Greek world and an ordinary greeting from the Hebrew world. And he took these greetings and he put them together and he made them into his mission statement. His goal was to bring grace into the lives of other believers. Like we studied last week, that they would hear words of grace, yes, but that they would experience God's grace and God's shalom, his peace, his spiritual wholeness. Is that your mission for life? To bring grace and peace into the lives of others? All right, here's our third question, and the one we're going to wrap up with that's in this passage. Do you trust God to work in your life and church for your good and for his glory? If you know who you are and who God has made you into, and you see all of your imperfections, but you know who you are, and if you are giving thanks and treasuring and loving and working for the grace of God in the life of the church, are you going to do it in your own strength, your own power, your own ability? Are you trusting in your own wisdom? Are you going to trust in God to finish that work that he began? Do you trust God to work in your life and church for your good and his glory? See, the Christian life, brothers and sisters, is so much comes down to who are we trusting in the moment. When we've got weakness in our marriage, weakness in our church, weakness in our child raising, weakness in how we carry out our jobs, are we going to trust in ourselves? Are we going to trust in Jesus? Look how Paul wraps this up in 1 Corinthians 1:9. God is faithful. God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. He says, oh, Corinthians, I know you guys are a mess, but you know what? I'm not looking at you. I'm looking at my faithful God. I know that it's going to be hard work for me to write this letter and address all these issues, but I've got a faithful God. And you may be wondering how I could give thanks for you, because we are a hot mess. But God is faithful. Paul's confidence isn't in the Corinthians. His confidence isn't in his arguments. His confidence isn't in who he is. His confidence is in the faithful God who has called all of them into this relationship. And so he makes this commitment to reach into their lives, bring them grace and peace, because he knows that God is faithful to love his church and keep his promises. Do you know that today? That God is never going to stop loving you? That there's absolutely nothing you can do today to make God love you less? You might be less pleasing, but he will never love you less. He will never fail to keep his promises. This is who he is. All the way back to the children of Israel, God reveals himself as a faithful God. Look at Deuteronomy 7:9. Know therefore that the Lord your God is God, the faithful God who keeps covenant, who's going to keep that promised relationship and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations. God is faithful. He's going to love you. He's going to keep his promises to you. The promises of God are for every generation who trusts him. And he's faithful, brothers and sisters, to forgive us and to cleanse us. You may have, even right now during today's message, God may have brought to mind some unbelief, some fears, some doubts, some sins. He may have brought some of these things in your mind and heart, and you may be convicted, and that's a good thing. But I want you to know this, that he's faithful to forgive you and cleanse you from your sins. 1 John 1:9 has this wonderful promise. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God is never going to be less than faithful to you. He will forgive you. If you come to him and you cry out to him and say, oh, God, forgive me, you confess your sins, he will not only forgive you of those sins, he'll begin that process of re-sanctifying you, making you into a saint, cleansing you out, and reshaping your heart. He's faithful to free you, brothers and sisters, not only from the penalty of sin, but also from its power. He doesn't want you to live in spiritual bondage. Paul's going to write to the Corinthian church, and we're going to study this in depth, but I want you to see it right now. He's going to say, brothers and sisters, God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond your ability, but with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape that you may be able to endure it. That means that as Christians, we will never experience a temptation to pride or gossip or selfishness or pornography or laziness or apathy or any other temptation that God will not give us the freedom from. That's an amazingly powerful promise of God. He's faithful to protect us from the evil one, protect us from disease. We've all been stretched in these last few weeks to ask ourselves, do we trust that God can protect us? Listen, I wear the mask, I wear the gloves, I go out there, I do what is wise, I keep those social distancing lines. We do all those things just like we would wear seatbelts in a car. But here's the thing, I know this, that God alone can protect me, that God alone can protect you. That we cannot stop ourselves from getting a disease just by our own behaviors. We can't determine whether or not we take our next breath. We need to trust that God is the one who is going to protect us in all situations. The Lord is faithful, brothers and sisters. He will establish you in your faith and guard you against the evil one. Isn't that a wonderful promise? Notice who was that who got that promise? The Thessalonians. Once again, Paul wrote this promise while living out his pastoral ministry in Corinth. He said, oh, do you know that God's going to establish you, Corinthians? He's going to guard you against the evil one. Even if you're being persecuted, even if you're suffering for the sake of the name, even if you don't know what your next, where your next meal is coming from, know that God will guard you and protect you because that's who he is. And he is faithful to make us holy, to make us holy. Once again, let's take a look at what Paul wrote to the Thessalonian church, and you'll see how this heartbeat for this apostle for his church is that God, the God of peace, a God of wholeness, would sanctify the church completely. He knew they had been declared holy, and now he was waiting to see them live out the reality of that holiness in the midst of ordinary lives. He wanted his people to become ordinary saints. And what's his hope there? He who calls you is faithful. He will do it. Paul's not trusting the Corinthians to change. He's not trusting the Thessalonians to change. He's trusting God to do a work of making him, his church, his fellow believers, these broken people into the holy saints that God wants them to do. And he's hinging and betting his whole life and his whole ministry on the fact that God's at work making a people who are holy unto him. And we can rest in that same promise as we strive to become those ordinary saints that God is calling us to do and to be. So, brothers and sisters, I want to encourage you right now. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer and ask God to be the God who is faithful to us to make us into these ordinary saints as we live out the reality of our faith in Jesus. Heavenly Father, would you do this work? We don't feel like we've been sainted, assembled. We don't feel like we've been called. We don't feel very often like we are people who are going to get completed and sustained to the end. We don't feel very grateful very often for each other, and we confess that as a sin, that we're not excited about the work you're doing in the lives of other people. In fact, too often we focus critically on their flaws and on their weaknesses instead of seeing the greater story you're writing in their life and into ours. So Lord, give us a vision, a passion to see that better news that you are writing over our lives, that you are a God who is faithful to begin this work and to complete this work, to make us truly holy people, living out the reality of our saving faith. We don't want this to be some excuse to not do the work that you've called us to, to not be who you want us to be. But oh God, we are so grateful that your grace is greater, that you will gift and provide us with everything that we need. And we know that we don't deserve this, we can't earn it, but we ask that you would do this work in each of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to move now into a time of celebration of the Lord's Supper. If you are a member or regular attender of Redeemer, we have worked this week to get you a little communion cup. I hope that you have this, and if you don't, you may want to retrieve the little cup that we got to you that's got a wafer on top. There's a couple of different flaps here we'll ask you to open in just a minute. But before we do that, I'm going to just remind you of what this supper is about. And then Jason's going to lead us in a time of meditation and reflection in song. And then after that song, we're going to share in communion together. So what is this little plastic cup full of juice and this little wafer about? Well, it's at least about four things. It's about a testimony of the church. The testimony is that we are sinners. We need to be washed clean by the blood of Jesus. We need someone else to bear in their bodies our sin. And that's what the bread represents. So it's a testimony. It's more than just a testimony, though. It's actually a statement of faith. here we say that this body, this blood represented by this ordinary juice and ordinary cracker is enough. It was enough to pay for my sins. When Jesus bore my sins on the cross, it was enough, and I don't have to. When Jesus shed his blood to give me a new relationship with God, that was enough to bring me into relationship. So it's a statement of faith. It's also a statement that God's done this not just for me, but for a community. It's a declaration of a family. It's saying, I belong to a family of God, that I've been assembled into this body, just like we were talking about. And therefore, if you are not sure if you are part of this body, we don't want you to partake of this. We want you to pause. And if you've got a broken relationship with somebody in this body, I think it would be dishonoring to the intent of this to say, I'm going to partake of this and pretend that I don't have broken relationship with my fellow believers. We don't want to do that. So at the very least, confess that to God and commit to fixing that broken relationship as quickly as you can. If you're not sure what you believe about the body and blood of Jesus and the work that he has done, then I want to encourage you to contact me via email, text, or phone after this service is over. We want to share more of the good news of Jesus with you. The fourth thing that this cup represents is that we are, in fact, crying out with our lives, Maranatha. We are waiting for the return of Jesus. We know that we celebrate this supper only until Jesus returns. When he comes back, there will be a better supper that he has promised, and he will dress himself to serve and seat us at a table, and he will serve us as we remember the greatness of his love, the majesty of his grace, the power of the cross, and rejoicing we will be together with him forever. So here we say, we are waiting, Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. So I want to invite you to spend some time as we go through this song, in confession, in prayer, in reflection, and asking God where you're at with him, preparing your hearts to partake of this supper. We're going to let Jason lead us in worship now.
I once was lost in darkest night, but I knew the way, the sin that brought joy and light had led me to the grave. I had known that you alone are able to your will. And if you had not loved me first, I would refuse you soon. But as I ran my hellbound race, indifferent to the cross, you looked upon my helpless state and led me to the cross. And I beheld God's love displayed, you suffered in my place. You bore the wrath reserved for me. Now all I know is grace. Hallelujah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus is. So all my seed, the strength to follow your commands could never come from me. Oh, Father, use my ransom life in any way you choose, and let my song forever be. My only boast is you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus is my life. Hallelujah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus is my life.
Let's sing one more time.
Hallelujah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus is my
Let's try this. Here we go. I want to remind each of you what God has done for us through his son in his body, that our Lord and Savior on the night he was betrayed took bread and passed it amongst his disciples. Breaking it, he said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Now you can open up that second flap of the juice there. In the same way, after the supper, our Lord took the cup and passed it amongst his disciples. And he said, "Drink this, all of you, for this is the new covenant given to you in my blood, which is shed for you." For as often as we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he returns.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song. His cornerstone, his solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless faith, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay. Light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, His curse has lost its grip on me. For I am His, and He is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from His hand till He returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand.
See, no power.
No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from His hand till He returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
In Ephesians 3:14 through 19, for this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of His glory, He may grant you to be strengthened with the power through His Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Let's say a short prayer. Father God, we ask to be humble, that we might bow before you. Father, it is by you that everything in heaven and in earth was created.